PA Trendlines presents an episode of The Disruptors.
Welcome to Accounting Disruptor Conversations. I'm your host, Liz Farr from CPA Trendlines. My guest today is Mike Whitmire, CEO and co-founder of Flowcast. How are you doing today, Mike?
I'm doing very well, Liz. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Now, most of my guests on this podcast have been from public accounting, but we tend to ignore the concerns of accountants in industry. And the reason I invited Mike is because he's got a very interesting history. He started at EY and then moved to a tech startup. And now he's running a tech company that serves accountants in industry with workflow management software, which I think is totally cool. And full disclosure, Flowcast is one of the companies that I write content for. And it was in working with you, Mike, and your team that I learned about a lot of the concerns of accountants in industry. I learned that accountants in industry have a lot of the same challenges that accountants in public accounting have, but they're just a little bit different. And so that's why I wanted to bring you on board.
Awesome. Well, and I forgot to mention, thank you for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
That's great. Yeah, I'm glad you could carve out the time from your busy schedule to be here.
Of course.
Now, one of the concerns that accountants all over the world have is talent. And in the US and all around the world, talent has been scarce for years. The Great Resignation and COVID made it worse. Now, what are some things that you can think of to make it better? And what have you seen organizations do successfully?
So in the short term, it's sort of a challenging problem to solve. Yes, it's there. It's not getting any better. And so, I mean, you do just kind of see capitalism coming into play here. Salaries are going up to recruit people into your finance and accounting function. And, you know, I think a lot of executives are used to not spending a ton of money on G&A and, oh, accountant shouldn't cost a ton of money. But when there's a supply and demand issue, the way to increase demand for your company is to raise salaries and pay more. And that's what a lot of people are doing. So accountants are just making more money to go to different places, which makes new opportunities really interesting to them. You know, a common thing that happens within the workforce is if you start a new career at a company, you get those sort of minimal raises along the way that do not keep up with fair market. And so you hear of a lot of accountants who are maybe a senior accountant, they're like, oh, someone offered me a 30% raise. It's like, yeah, that's where market is now. Things have changed that quickly because a lot of companies have huge profits that they're turning right now coming out of COVID. A lot of, if you're in the SaaS or if you're in the technology world, there's so much venture funding going out there that these companies can afford to pay a little bit more. And so that's what's happening to attract talent to your company. The other thing is using a lot of technology to automate a ton of the more mundane work so that you can do more with less people. That's just sort of the other switch that you can make to help make that possible. And the other one is like starting to take risks on people from outside of accounting. Can I train someone to do billing? Can I train someone to be an AP clerk? Like those kind of baseline roles. Can we just simply train people into those positions? So in the short term, those are the fixes. In the longer run, we need to do a lot of things to help the profession. I mean, fewer people are majoring in accounting than ever really before. And so we need to figure out a way to kind of elevate the profession, spotlight it a little bit more, really highlight it as a profession, not a job, right? There are a lot of things that go into being an accountant. I think it can just be perceived as a boring tax job when the reality is there are a lot of options within there. So resetting the stereotype and also making it easier to get educated in this field and actually get into the world of accounting. You know, today, the general career path that like 99% of people go through is you go to school, you major in accounting, you go to audit, you get your CPA exam, and then you either move up to partner or you attrition out and you move over into industry. And then there's this weird stigma of industry wrapped around all of that. And that stigma, to be totally blunt, is created by the audit firms, right? It's not in their best interest to have people graduate school and go straight into industry. They need them to come into the audit firm, work for a few years, hold that CPA carrot over them to force people to work before they can move off into industry. And so I think if we could rethink, hey, if you major in accounting, it's okay to do accounting after that, perhaps that could be a good shift for the, in terms of the industry being able to recruit people into like staff accountant roles. Cause that's a role that's shockingly difficult to hire for, right? Because there's so few people who have 0 to 1 years of experience who will take a staff accountant role. They've all been in audit for a few years. And so they want to be at least a senior accountant, if not an accounting manager. So I think education needs to change. I think the way we teach students to do this can be way easier. You don't need a four-year degree. You don't need to spend 200 grand to go get this degree just so you can become a CPA, when the reality is most people who work in audit ultimately move over to industry are corporate accountants, not auditors or tax preparers. So I don't know, a big change in mentality is how we kind of solve the problem going forward. And it's going to take some time, but hey, at Flowcast, we're also trying to help with a lot of those areas.
Yeah, I agree with everything you're saying. You know, I've talked to auditors who think that, you know, one way to staff up some of the ticking and tying positions is just to bring in people who are AP and AR clerks who maybe don't have a whole lot of experience other than just doing that and who like doing that kind of work, and letting them do that kind of work instead of bringing in a four-year college degree CPA to do the really boring stuff that nobody wants to do.
I would much rather have a former AP clerk auditing accounts payable than someone who just graduated college. No, absolutely. Like not even close. And that was the big epiphany that I had when I moved from audit into corporate accounting is I'm like, this is so backwards. This is so backwards. How is an auditor prepared to tell a professional that they're doing their job incorrectly when they've never done that job before? Like that was the crux of what just began to really frustrate me, is all of a sudden I was actually doing the accounting and I had these, you know, for lack of a better word, I had these kids who had never done this crap before, giving me, asking me all these really dumb questions about my job, and it just killed me. And I had this thought, and then sorry, later in my time at that company, it was funny, the partner for the audit firm tried to recruit me to go be an auditor. And I had this thought, I was like, oh, what if I did go back to audit? I would be a dangerous auditor right now. Like right. I know where people can hide the skeletons. I know how these transactions work. I know what reconciliations look like. I know the ERP really well now. And I would just be so much more dangerous actually having practical experience rather than going to school, learning theoretical stuff for the CPA exam and being trained on the job. Like just doing the work makes it way easier to audit the work afterwards. And I think we need to flip that approach to the industry, which is a big statement to make, but I think that would result in better audits and a better industry overall.
Absolutely. And I've heard other people talk about making it more of a revolving door between audit and industry so that it's not such a stigma, because you gain so much by being on the other side. Mm-hmm. You really do.
Yeah. And that's a really interesting point, because it's audit is up or out mentality, right? That's how it works in an audit firm. Mm-hmm. And I think it's sort of, I mean, it's the reality is it's that way because there are very few partner opportunities available and people get burned out because of all the hours that they have to work. So perhaps if an audit firm could pay a more meaningful compensation package to like a manager and have better work-life balance for that manager, maybe some people from industry would be interested in boomeranging back into audit. But the reality is, once you get out of that life, you go to industry, it's a little bit easier. You're not working quite as many hours as the auditors. It is not appealing at all to go be an audit manager and see when you know how much they grinded when you were at the firm.
Absolutely. You know, and one guy I've talked to suggests that during summer, some of the audit firms send their staff members out to some of their clients to just work in the accounting office for a couple of months and just learn the business, just do it for free even, and just learn how it works.
Yeah. And so this also goes back to the talent shortage issue, right? A lot, thinking back to my audit days, there's so much time spent training people, explaining things to people, ramping them up. And it's because there's not an understanding of why we're doing the work we're doing. It's just like, what do I have to do? Tell me how to do it. And you just kind of follow instructions, right? So that means that when you go to every new engagement, you're just there to follow instructions. Let me look at the work papers from last year. I'm going to roll it forward. I'm going to do all this stuff. But the reality is a lot of things have happened in the last 12 months since that last work paper was completed. And you need to have a bit more of an objective mentality to really be good at this job. So imagine if everybody knew the why behind the audit work that they were doing. All of a sudden, I'm a staff, but I've done accounting for 3 years. I get this stuff. I don't have to bother my senior about why am I looking at this? What transactions do I pick? Why do I look at this? Because you know, oh, I should probably be focusing on the larger transactions. That's what's material. And then I'll do a random sampling, see if they punched all this stuff in. Here's what I know to look for, because when I was doing this job, this was the hard stuff, blah, blah, blah. So I think it would add a ton of efficiency, just soft efficiencies with the lack of training needed, quicker ramp periods across engagements. And that right there might be something that just helps with the talent shortage, because auditors will be better at their job.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and another thing that is really, that's a big challenge in accounting these days is technology. It's changing the way accountants do their work. It's changing how teams are structured. What are some of the changes that you're seeing in the companies that you work with?
Well, I mean, tech. So I think it's unfair, and Liz is kind of a new thing I've been talking about. I think it's unfair to just say technology, like blanket use the term technology,
right.
Because there's good technology and there's bad technology, and there's poor user experience, there's good user experience. Right. There are solutions that say, hey, you've been doing this the complete wrong way your entire life. That's horrible. You have to do it our way. There are other companies like Flowcast where we lean into the workflows that are done today. We understand how people work. We just insert software that makes everything more efficient for you. And so I really think the notion of technology being scary, a lot of that's driven by old software that quite frankly is just clunky to use and isn't good. It's cumbersome, right? So I think with a lot of the newer applications that are coming out, that's starting to fade away because there's very much a focus on, you know, how is the job getting done today? What is the user actually doing every single day? And how do I build software that solves that problem of the user? And if you're solving the pain point of the user, they're going to use your software because they enjoy it because it's making their life easier. And that's going to make your team more efficient. So if I think about the old guard of technology companies, SAP, Oracle, you know, kind of like that generation, it's a bunch of just founders who are not accountants. They're business development people, right? They're database people. And they said, I want to make something for accountants. And they're thinking like technologists, not like accountants. In the more modern world of technology, someone like myself, who's just an accountant, can go out and start to build a company because software is much easier to build now. And since I actually did the job, I'm going to be thinking about myself and how do I build software that would help my actual pain point. And then what that means is it actually gets adopted. So I think technology, old technology can be a very scary thing because it's difficult implementations, high risk, moderate reward, and maybe not the most user-friendly. But newer technology, as long as it's built right, I view it as a very low risk, very high reward proposition that will make the whole team better. So yeah, just depends on which software you're looking at.
Yeah. You know, a lot of the other people I've talked to have emphasized the importance of process. Mm-hmm. That you've got to nail down your process first before you figure out what software tool to use that will fit in there best.
Yeah, that's and we talk about this a lot at Flowcast, right? The classic people, process, technology. It's a trope for a reason because it's very true. So you can't just hire a controller and not write anything down and then layer software on top of that to make it better. That's not how it's going to work. So
No. We
oftentimes work with some of our earlier stage clients of, hey, let's get a month-end close checklist documented. You know, everything's in your head right now. Let's get this on paper. Here's a stock checklist we start with. Let's get everything written down. And once it's written down and you've operated in that environment for a few months or a couple quarters, you can make revisions to your process. And once you feel like it's pretty solid, then you can put it into something like a Flowcast. And then it's really up to us to build software that's easy to administer, is flexible enough to scale with that client. Because the reality is processes are changing, right? Every year, hopefully your business is growing. Hopefully your business is changing. And so new processes are going to be added or revised or whatnot. And you need a solution that's adaptable for that environment.
Yeah. You know, and speaking of companies growing, you know, as they scale and grow, their accounting needs change also. What can controllers and CFOs put in place from day one to make it easier down the road?
Well, you know, I don't want to selfishly plug Flowcast, but I will say we help companies scale in a big way, and it, you know, we start to make sense at around five or six people. So the phases of accounting, I would say, is zero to five is, you know, obviously make sure you have QuickBooks or Xero or something in place you're using as a GL, and then start to look at solutions that can automate a lot of those bespoke workflows that are really complicated. So at that stage, I would start to look at something like a bill.com to help with that process. It's a job that one person's doing. You can help automate it. Another one would be on the sales tax side. There are quite a few vendors. The biggest one is Avalara, right? So sales tax is a high risk thing that you have to deal with. And it's very, very, very complicated. And there's a great piece of software that can help with all of that. So that's one where, like, when we first hired our controller, he came in and was like, what are we doing with taxes? And I said, I'm burying my head in the sand on taxes. Let's go do some voluntary disclosures in all these various states. So he implemented Avalara. We went out and did that. And it was really impactful for us. Then when you hit around five or six, all of a sudden, you know, you're really focused on closing the books. You probably have some reporting requirements. You're probably being audited at that point. And you have to collaborate around the close. And it's like a all hands on deck type situation. And that's where something like Flowcast starts to become important. It documents your workflow, keeps your team on the same page. You know, you have that peace of mind that all the reconciliations have been completed. And it puts you in a position to then scale as you add more process, procedure, control, and whatnot, as you bring on more people. And then, you know, you get that pre-IPO phase, call it 15 to 30 accountants in the team. And all of a sudden you're thinking, okay, how do we close fast enough now to get reporting out the door on time, to make sure that we are in compliance with our audit, make sure all of our controls are in place and being properly tracked. So it just becomes more complex, but you're still in that, oh crap, we got to get stuff done, like all hands on deck mentality, because you're understaffed still heading into an IPO. And then you go public, you start to scale, the board gives you more resources, you can really codify things and standardize it, and people start to specialize, and you can continue to refine your processes and scale. And at that point, that's really where you'll have all your point solutions. You've probably upgraded ERPs, you know, maybe you went like Intact or NetSuite at some point and then switched over to an Oracle, an SAP, a Workday or whatever. But that end of the range though, to plug Flowcast, we scale that whole way. We've helped many companies scale through their multiple ERP transitions at this point, but it does become process, workflow, collaboration, and those kind of bigger ERP systems is what's most important at the later stage.
Yeah, I agree with the need to get workflow in there. You know, I was helping out as, I guess they were calling me sort of a virtual or outsourced CFO for some company, but I didn't know what the heck I was really doing. And they didn't have any processes. They didn't really have anybody. And it was just a mess. And, you know, if they had just had somebody sit down and figure out their processes, then I might have been able to actually do something. But instead, you know, they had me out there, they're paying our firm to have me out there about 30 hours a week to just do, you know, why? I don't know why I was out there, but I was out there doing nonsense work.
Like baseline bookkeeping type stuff?
Not really bookkeeping, but a lot of what they had me do was work on this gigantic spreadsheet that was their budget and their projections for the future.
Oh, okay.
So that was what I spent a lot of my time on, and trying to collect information from people in the company to make estimates. And
It seems like a poor use of your skills, but okay.
I would second that. Yep. I would agree with that there. Now, speaking of skills, what skills do accountants need to be successful today and in the future?
I'll go with the, you know, classic, getting up to speed on technology and making sure you're open to that and embracing it. but I will say the cool change that we're seeing, and I don't know if it's a new skill that accountants have to learn. I think it's more of an acknowledgement that we have this skill and this knowledge already, and we should be applying it to something different. That's really what I want to chat about. Is we've noticed that with a lot of our clients at Flowcast, you know, we started with the month-end close, right? We know this. So we help with the month-end close. Close management software is what we started as. And then we realized that about 30% of our clients were responsible for tracking workflows outside of the close process. And so this included things like payroll, SEC reporting, PBC collection, this is just random workflows that occur. And when you start to dig through all this stuff that was set up in Flowcast, you're like, oh, wow, the controller is responsible for a lot of workflow and sort of the operational cadence of the entire office of the CFO. And so we started interviewing our clients and talking to them more about this. And it became very apparent that when you get to that kind of controller level, the numbers matter for sure. But really, it's about how do I drive efficiency for the entire office of the CFO? And that comes at looking at processes, procedures, policies, and figuring out where we can improve, where we can get better, tracking people, allowing them to collaborate, making sure stuff's done by the appropriate date every single month, so we're operating in cadence. And I'm thinking about it, and it's like, you know, accountants have the stereotype of bean counters, right? Which, for starters, let me just say, in what world is being a bean counter a bad thing? Like, isn't it good that I can count my beans and you can't? I don't understand why that's an insult, but whatever, I'll table that. The reality is, when you think about accounting, what we're good at is understanding rules and regulations and guidance. We know the art of accounting and the kind of science and the puzzle and how all of that comes together. And one of my favorite quotes is Warren Buffett, who said, accounting is the language of business. And it's so true, because when you know the numbers and the guidance and regulation and policy and everything, you really do get how the entire business operates. And so if we're talking about operations and how we're already seeing controllers do this and the skill set and knowledge that accountants already have, you know, you can kind of think of operations as, it's like the playbook for how to run your business, right? It's this playbook of everything that's written down. So the question I have is, shouldn't the playbook be written by somebody who understands the language of business?
Right.
And so with that, I believe the current state of forward thinking accounting departments and the future of all accounting departments is much more operational than what we're doing today. So it's getting out of reconciliations. It's, you know, who cares about a $4 difference? Technology will probably find that for you. We'll automate a lot of that mundane work, allow accountants to elevate and more think about the processes and procedures around the company, the operations, the cadence, and looking for ways to improve how the business is run. Really, that's where I think we're going. We're seeing it already, and we are pushing that agenda in a big way, and our software is there to support that transition along the way.
One thing that I've heard from a lot of people is just the need to understand businesses better. That's something that people in public accounting don't really take the time to do enough of, is to understand how their clients' businesses operate. And from what you're saying, it sounds like the accountants on the industry side could also benefit from understanding how their own companies operate and getting a bigger picture view of how things work and trying to optimize what operations are going on.
That statement very much surprises me. In my opinion, at EY, the most valuable thing I got was learning how businesses operate.
Really?
By far, like not even close. Yeah. And I sort of had a main rotation of four audit clients, but I audited, got good exposure to maybe like 20 different audits. And the first mandate was, before you show up on site, learn about the company, learn about what they do. That's great. And then the second is, when you get there, you start walking through there, you start reviewing walkthroughs, narratives, controls, processes, procedures. And that's how the business operates. So when you're looking at the numbers behind the scenes, you're auditing all of this, you can follow transactions, you see how payroll works, you see how, you know, I was in the entertainment world, so I got to see how they funded various filming investments. Oh, you set up a separate entity when you want to record a new film, you're going to do it in Nevada or Georgia or Canada because you get tax benefits, right? You learn all about how a business operates from behind the scenes. So that to me almost feels like it's an auditor who perhaps did not take advantage of the opportunity that was put in front of them to learn as much as they could have learned. And that's super concerning to me, because the best thing about audit is how much you can learn as an auditor. It's like, I learned so much doing audit. Maybe I just tried to learn out of it, but like, that's incredibly disappointing that someone says that they don't feel as though they're prepared to help with operations coming out of audit. I'm gonna put on that person.
Yeah, well, this comes from a lot of conversations I've had with Al Anderson, who said that he has three questions that he asks auditors when he goes in to train them. The first is, what was the bottom line on your last audit? What was their net income? And almost no one knows that. The second one is, how many pages in your disclosure checklist? Everyone knows that. And the third question is, how did that company make money? And a surprising number of people will say things like, well, that wasn't my audit area, so I didn't have to know that. You were fortunate that you had exposure to managers and partners who emphasized that.
You know what I think the difference might be is, So I was a pain in the ass employee. Like, I will fully acknowledge that, right? And so I would get bored auditing the same account twice. And so I would literally ask to do something else. Like, I did cash once. I was like, have someone else do that. Can I do film capitalization? Can I do stock comp expense? Can I do payroll? Can I do something different? And I also ended up on mid-market companies. So I was able to look at the entire business holistically and understand everything that was going on. Like, one of my projects was going in and an entertainment company, converting them from cash to GAAP accounting. And to do that, I had to go back in time 3 or 5 years and restate everything. And when you're rebuilding a balance sheet, I'm learning a whole lot about how this company audits, you're doing walkthroughs, preparing narratives and everything. I'm learning about the operations. I wouldn't say the question of what was their net income last year is a reflection of operations. I think that's more of a reflection around a lot of people are put on jobs where, yeah, they don't have exposure to many accounts. They're tunnel vision siloed on, I got to get through the AP audit. That's my only job here on the General Electric audit, right? Like, you can be put on these huge clients and just be siloed into a very small area and not learn a lot as a result of that. But if you're able to get into more of a mid-market size company, go up and down the balance sheet, get exposure to multiple companies and like try to learn about business through that, I think it's an amazing opportunity.
Yeah. So I think what you're saying is that it takes initiative to want to explore different areas. And it also takes management and supervisors who are willing to give you that.
I guess I think it's very much on the individual to decide how they want to approach their time in audit. You can be one of the people who's negative about it. You gripe about it. You complain about the hours. Oh, this job is stupid, blah, blah, blah. And you can hate your life and not get anything out of it. You can certainly take that approach if you want, or you can flip that around and say, yes, I'm working a lot, but I'm learning a lot. I'm getting exposure to a lot of different things. I'm taking the access that I have to extremely sensitive financial information and learning as much as I can about how businesses run and decisions they make and why they make these different decisions. And if you do that, what ultimately happens, right, is you work more hours. If you're trying to learn, you learn more, which means that over the course of a 3 or 4 year timeframe inside of audit, I was working probably 3,000 hours a year. I got 12,000 hours of experience over a 4 year period. That's a lot. I got like over 10,000 hours and I was very focused on learning. And that put me in a great position heading into industry from there. So, you know, a manager can only do so much. They can't create a person's, you know, personality. They can't rah-rah you into actually caring about what you're doing and wanting to get what's best for you out of the position. So I'm going to throw it on the individual. Like they got to be more, they have to understand the opportunity that's in front of them more, as long as they have the right attitude and approach it the right way.
What I'm hearing from you is that a skill that will help people be more successful is just curiosity.
Totally.
And it's just that simple.
There's the saying of curiosity killed the cat, right? My grandma always used to say that to me. It's like, she's one of the most influential people in my entire life. That's a saying I completely disagree with. That is, to like wrap curiosity around a negative thing is totally incorrect. I think it's a huge and important part of life. Yeah. If you're genuinely curious about this account that you're auditing, you're just going to get the job done better. You're going to learn more. You're going to know what's going on. You're not just going to be copy pasting tick marks from the prior year. Where does this bold red tick mark A go within this work paper? Like, it's just more entertaining. It's really more entertaining.
I agree with you there. You know, that it would have been much more entertaining to me if I had had that managers who really wanted me to do that rather than just saying, well, here's last year's work papers, follow that.
Yeah, like, because for a lot of managers, that is the easier way to train, right? Is to just say, do it the same as last year is so common that it's an acronym. You have the SALI acronym going all around audit. So I completely agree. And I'll say, looking back on my experience, the moment that changed for me was when I went to an audit job where there were no prior year work papers, first year audit.
That
could probably be a very good learning experience for a lot of people if they had no prior year work papers to leverage to do their audit this year, because you do have to figure out, why am I doing this? How do I do it? And what's the output of all of it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What is the reason for doing this procedure? Yeah. And is there an easier way to get to it that I can think of? Maybe using technology. Is there an analytic? Can I use AI? Can I do something else?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All kinds of opportunity. And accountants are very good at finding efficiencies, I've found.
They are.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what do you think accountants should stop doing immediately?
Well, I've hammered on a bit of the woe is me mentality within the audit world. I'm going to go back to that one. Like, yeah, there is a bit of a personal responsibility in looking at the opportunity that you have and trying to make the most of it rather than complaining about it and being a negative Nancy around the office. So I'm going to say, stop being negative and complaining about stuff. Focus on the opportunity that's in front of you. Try to learn as much as possible. And when you feel like you've learned enough, then figure out what you want to do with your career next, whether you now enjoy audit and you want to stay in that field, do that. Or if you think you're ready to go to industry and want to really be part of one company where you're part of a team, you're building something, you're trying to get better, then go take that opportunity.
Yeah. Or the final path is to follow in your footsteps, Mike, and found a company.
You could do that. And it's funny because I credit a lot of my ability to do this back to my time in audit because of how much I learned about how businesses run.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you know, just this morning on tax Twitter, a professor said that he took an informal poll of the students in his accounting principles 101 course. And 75% of them said that they wanted to start their own business, which is, that's a big change from when I was taking classes and from when you were taking classes, probably.
Yeah. Entrepreneurship is strong with this generation, and it is easier than ever to start a business. So that makes all the sense in the world to me.
Yeah. Now, accountants tend to be a little bit slow to change. It's probably more so over on the public side than in industry. But what are the main barriers to keeping accountants from changing and trying new things?
So this is actually an area I'm coming to disagree with. I don't think it's the accountants. I think it's actually more the technology vendors and security requirements. So I would argue good technology has not been available to them for a very long period of time. I think about 10 years ago is when good solutions for various problems started to present themselves, and people are open to change if there's a good way to solve my problem. The other thing holding us back is budgets. CFOs and the CIOs not opening up budget to give to the back office. You know, there's always room for another sales tool. There isn't necessarily room for something for the accounting department. So as IT budgets continue to expand, there's only so much stuff the go-to-market team can buy. Ultimately, some of that trickles down into the back office, and we see a lot of companies deploying more of that capital that's available to them. And then the other side is on security. It's been a while getting people comfortable with the cloud. You know, accounting and finance are kind of the last group to get comfortable with the cloud. We feel as though we're finally there at like mass acceptance. It's very rare that we talk to a company that has a zero cloud policy. And so I don't think it's the accounts. I think it's the industry. So it's the technology being available, the budget being available, and the comfortableness with the cloud. That's really all caught up. And now we're seeing accounts adopt new technology really quickly. Like I don't see us on many demos where people are like, oh, I've always done it this way. I just want to keep doing it this way. It's like there's a talent shortage. People are looking to do things better. They want to do more with less people, and they're turning to technology to do it.
That is probably spot on. And, you know, from my time in accounting, in public accounting, I would agree that the technology was really pretty lame. You know, the tax software was still the same ugly gray screens and black print and hard to read, hard to use, not very user friendly. So once you figured out how to use this really clunky piece of software, and if you saw that every other piece of tax or audit software was equally clunky and ugly, it was really hard to get people to change. But I think you're right that the technologies that are available now, the good technologies, to go back to what you said before, those are really helping people to bridge the gap and to make the changes that they need to.
And I'll also harken back to when technology and software first started to become available to business in general, right? It was like spreadsheets and ERPs became available. Those were kind of the first two things that came out that really businesses adopted in mass. And the function that adopted both of those in the biggest way possible, the first ones to bring technology into business, were the finance and accounting functions. Like, they're the ones who use Excel for everything. They're the ones who own the ERP and use it for the most part. Things like HR software, marketing automation, CRMs, and sales automation, and all that stuff, that came later. Accounts were the first one to pick up technology.
That's true. That's very true. Now, speaking of technology, and we've been talking about things changing and getting better, what do you think is the next big thing in accounting technology? What's the next big thing on the horizon?
I think the next big thing is rethinking a lot of the transactional work that's being done and how data is ingested, how it is then reconciled through the entire process to ensure that all these various systems that we're using, that there's good data integrity across it. That's a integration points, right? Technology is great, but that integration point is where things can go right or go wrong. And so you need this ability to kind of validate all that data and make sure it's accurate and you're getting what you need out of the technology. And so I think that automating of the super manual, tedious, like back and forth, ticking and tying work, that needs to go away so that the industry can follow this operational path that I truly believe that we are already on, but we want to continue because that's a more fun part of the job, right? I'd rather be working with our sales ops team to learn about how we can optimize the commission preparation process across our teams. How can we get this done faster, more accurately? How can we make sure sales is happy? How do we structure the plan such that the business gets what they need out of these and the sales reps are going to be motivated? How do we go back and forth on these things? I'd rather do that than rip through a bank account and go transaction by transaction and start to, you know, reconcile it. So I think that sort of automating of the manual, allowing teams to elevate and do, you know, the word strategy is used, but I really think it's operational work. I think that's where we're best suited, is to help on the operation side.
I think that is the perfect way to end up our conversation, coming back to operations. Thank you so much for talking to me, Mike. And if people want to reach out to you, how can they find you?
LinkedIn is definitely the best place. So I'm just Mike Whitmire. You'll see an inactive CPA because per the ethics exam, I have to disclose that I'm an inactive CPA since I have not stayed up on my CPE credits. Connect with me on LinkedIn. Would love to get connected, and then have a podcast as well called Blood, Sweat, and Balance Sheets. Have a great book that I had a wonderful writer help me out on called The Controller's Code. You can check that one on Amazon as well. But yeah, LinkedIn is definitely the best way to get connected.
All right. Well, thanks very much. You have a great day now, Mike.
Awesome. You too. Thank you so much for having me, Liz. Really enjoyed the conversation.
Great.